As a longtime comics fan, I was shocked to find out just how many adaptations of the legendary Swamp Thing character there are. And I was even more surprised to find out how many of them are absolute failures. It's surprising to see such a popular comic character fail to gain a mainstream audience. In this video, we'll look at the many failures of Swamp Thing. If you're unfamiliar, Swamp Thing is a DC Comics character created by writer Len Wein and Bernie Wrightson in House of Secrets number 92. Wrightson is a revered comic artist in his own right, and Wein brought us prevalent characters like Wolverine and the Ted Kord iteration of Blue Beetle. Swamp Thing is Alec Holland, a biologist developing a biorestorative formula to solve food shortages. Saboteurs blow up Holland's lab, sending his charred body and formula into the Louisiana bog. He reemerges as Swamp Thing, a being merged with plant life with incredible strength and an eye for justice. Swamp Thing's first adaptation is likely the most successful. This film was written and directed by horror master Wes Craven, the man behind A Nightmare on Elm Street and many, many other classics. This film mostly faithfully followed the comics. Alec Holland and his wife work on a biorestorative formula in the swamp. Their lab is attacked and blown up. Mrs. Holland dies, and Alec fuses with the swamp to become Swamp Thing and seeks revenge. One major deviation to the source is the melding of two Swamp Thing villains into one. Anton Arcane in the comics is an evil wizard whose malicious magic pitted him against Swamp Thing multiple times as his chief nemesis. Avery Sunderland is a CEO working on devious technological practices alongside shadowy government agencies, often seeking to capture Swamp Thing and replicate Holland's formula. The movie version of Arcane is a business owner with a passion for human experimentation and desire to use the coveted formula to achieve immortality. This interpretation of the character would carry throughout most adaptations. The acting is serviceable, the practical effects look good, with the unmen being particularly horrifying. I can really say I enjoyed this movie. That is until the final battle between Swamp Thing and Arcane, who turns into a pig monster in a cheap mask to sword fight Swamp Thing. I really can't understand why this happens. Critically, Swamp Thing would receive mixed reception and performed less than stellar financially, but has caught on in the cultural eye. In the comics, writer Alan Moore of Watchmen and V for Vendetta fame would take Swamp Thing in a new direction. While retaining its horror roots, Swamp Thing would tackle issues of racism, interspecies relationships, identity, and more. The saga of the Swamp Thing is regarded as one of the greatest comic runs of all time, and would rejuvenate interest in Swamp Thing. This would lead to the 1989 sequel film, The Return of Swamp Thing. The Return of Swamp Thing is a sequel to Craven's Swamp Thing in the same way the Incredible Hulk film is a sequel to Ang Lee's Hulk. The events of the past mostly happen, but take several liberties. Arcane is still alive, hunting for Swamp Thing. The movie is significantly more comedic, adding joke scenes with setups and punchlines, forcing in two obnoxious kid characters, likely to appeal to a younger audience.
Good grief, I could be home watching cable.
Swamp Thing speaks in a hammy, stunted voice, his entrances accompanied by a pan flute, likely to give him the air of a wizened nature warrior.
Did those men hurt you? I'm sorry. Sometimes I forget what I look like.
Add in some bafflingly overextended action scenes, and you get a movie that is wholly unlike its predecessor or the comics. Predictably, the movie bombed both critically and financially. Leading woman Heather Locklear won a Razzie Award for Worst Actress. Locklear apparently hated the Swamp Thing actor so much, she would force him off the set after each scene. The film grossed less than $250,000. Comic book legend Peter David hated the film so much, he rewrote the script as a novel, one the producers of the movie felt was so superior to their movie, they allowed it to be published. Despite Return's failure, two more adaptations would release the next year in 1990, likely because they were already well into production. There was an animated Swamp Thing released on Fox Kids, carrying over the kid-friendly cheesiness from Returns, and slathering in a noxious toyetic color palette, along with a lazy spoof of Chip Taylor's Wild Thing as its theme. An NES title released alongside it, and, from personal experience, is also very bad. You might be thinking how strange it is to take a horror comics character, recently rejuvenated for a more mature audience, and create two utterly kid-focused toy commercials. Around the same time, adult-oriented properties were being retooled for the kids' market. RoboCop, Police Academy, and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles received animated adaptations. Along with that, environmentalist messaging was on the rise. Captain Planet released this same year. However, there's a franchise that combines both aspects, which I feel influenced the attempt to revive Swamp Thing. 1984's Toxic Avenger is a superhero black comedy released by Troma Entertainment, known for creating comedic, gory B-movies. The film features a stereotypical nerd who falls into a drum of mysterious chemicals and emerges as the disfigured but powerful Toxic Avenger. With his mutated green skin and environmental messaging, it's not hard to see the similarities between these characters. The film was immensely popular at the time, remaining a cult classic to this day and releasing several sequels. In fact, Part 2 would release in 1989, the same year as The Return of Swamp Thing, which seemed to adopt Toxic Avenger's more comedic tone, though much less successfully. Also, cartoons for both properties would release pilots in 1990 before fully running in 1991. However, all this seems to be pure coincidence. I went searching around but couldn't find a direct acknowledgement of connection between these two franchises. It seems to just be one of those strange coincidences, like Paul Blart and Observe and Report filming at the same time. We're not done with 1990 yet, as a live-action Swamp Thing series would release that year. This series reaches a middle ground between the original film and its sequel, bringing back the darker tone but still keeping the obnoxious kid sidekicks. It takes cues from the horror roots of the comic, with anthology-style stories featuring voodoo priests, evil spirits, and mad science experiments, courtesy of a very smooth and horny Dr. Arcane, who once again is a CEO dabbling in black magic and black science. After episode 12, developer and producer Joseph Stefano would leave the series, replaced by Tom Green. Green sought to tilt even further toward the comic, becoming more focused on the adult cast and more explicit with its horror and violence. The child character Jim is replaced by his older half-brother Mark, and written out of the story by writing him kidnapped in a human trafficking scheme. This went completely unaddressed for several episodes until being mentioned that the kid was found off-screen. Truly one of the choices of all time. This series was one of USA Network's highest rated shows, and went on for 3 seasons, and it's not hard to see why. While the acting has that classic early 90s cheesiness, and the action scenes are less than impressive, the show has a very unique style and mood. The changes made by Green did a lot to polish the show's writing. Mark Lindsay Chapman as Anton Arcane is a real show stealer. His narcissistic, schmoozy take on the character brings both humor and danger to every scene, coming off as an evil version of David Tennant's Doctor Who mixed with a bit of Patrick Bateman. However, what I think makes this show considerable as a failure is admittedly a personal reason. I have never, in my many years as a comic fan and purveyor of cult media, heard anyone talk about this show. Despite reruns on networks like Sci-Fi and MeTV, I've never heard this show discussed by fans or referenced at all in any forums or recommendations of superhero media. Pre-millennium superhero media tends to fall by the wayside. There's an entire slew of Marvel characters that received movies long before the MCU, and stuff like the original Flash series or Wonder Woman aren't talked about much these days. But for the latter, they've at least maintained some pop cultural reference through references and parodies. The original Flash actor John Wesley Shipp appeared in the Flash TV series as Jay Garrick. For the former, those older Marvel movies are low budget and admittedly pretty bad, so maybe no one wants to remember them. But for a highly watched 3-season show with reruns based on an already popular character to receive so little word of mouth is just baffling to me. But let's move on. The Swamp Thing franchise would lay dormant for over a decade. There were talks of reviving the character for years, but nothing materialized until the 2019 Swamp Thing series. This series released on the DC Universe app, an at the time hub for DC original shows like Titans, Doom Patrol, and the Harley Quinn show, along with comic books to read. This series went hard into its horror roots, taking a lot of the best of Alan Moore's work on Swamp Thing, and slowly introducing elements of the wider DC Universe, such as The Green, Blue Devil, Madame Xanadu, and more. In this version, Alec Holland is a reporter. Abigail Arcane, Alec's love interest and niece of Anton Arcane, is a CDC virologist. Avery Sunderland is a business leader of the swampy town of Marai. The series would go on to achieve great acclaim, win several awards, and then be canceled after 10 episodes. But actually, that's not true. It was canceled before even a single episode was released. There are a few stories on why this happened. Changes in leadership direction and such. Season 1 was shortened from 13 episodes to 10, and the series was canceled before it even aired. This was a major blow, as Season 1 was clearly setting up a wider universe, and a Justice League Dark spinoff was planned. This is the magic and horror counterpart to the Justice League. And with such critical acclaim, this version of Swamp Thing seemed ripe for success.
It was originally reported that an accounting error on behalf of North Carolina was improperly filed, causing the show to go over budget, but that's been disputed by several parties. As of now, there's no definitive answer as to why Swamp Thing was shelved, sets left standing and abandoned, but I can think of a couple of reasons why Warner Media may have gotten cold feet on the project.
The show is certainly the most competent of the Swamp Thing adaptations. The story has a cohesive flow. The acting is good, especially Will Patton as Avery Sunderland and Kevin Durand as Jason Woodrum. The practical and special effects are impressive, though admittedly benefiting from most scenes taking place in a dark, damp swamp. But even at 10 episodes, the season tends to drag. Lots of extra side characters, long, drawn-out, dramatic scenes. These all serve to make the town of Marai feel more alive, and there was certainly the expectation of more seasons coming that would have benefited from a larger cast. But on rewatch of the series, I found myself fast-forwarding through many scenes not involving our central cast or the central plot. The season ends on a two-parter based heavily around Alan Moore's acclaimed anatomy lesson story, introducing the Floronic Man to be a nemesis for Swamp Thing. But I feel we could have gotten there in half the time and received a better-paced story. The second issue was the platform of release, the DC Universe app. While certainly popular amongst DC fans, the target audience, the app did not breach mainstream. And even with the supposed success of Swamp Thing, I can't imagine general audiences paying $8.99 a month for a mobile streaming app to watch one show. CW would rerun the series during the fall season of 2020, and likely would have become the Swamp Thing's home if it had been more successful. But this is all just speculation on my part. Currently, there's another Swamp Thing movie planned under James Gunn's leadership with no solid release date. Funnily enough, a Toxic Avenger remake premiered at Fantastic Fest last month. Strange how this keeps happening. I'm really hoping this upcoming film sees success. Swamp Thing is a legendary character with a plethora of rich stories to pull from that provide more than the typical superhero property can. The character is still well respected in comic circles, and still makes cameos to this day in The Harley Quinn Show, a playable fighter in Injustice 2, and more. If you're interested in getting into the character, I recommend going to the source. Len Wein and Bernie Wrightson's early horror stories pull back to the days of EC Comics and lay the groundwork for the character. Alan Moore's saga of the Swamp Thing is essential reading for any and all comic fans. Scott Snyder's New 52 run, teaming Swampy up with Animal Man into a world-changing event, is a ton of fun. Recently, literary horror writer Ram V has tackled the character, a worthy successor to Moore's style. If you like this video, subscribe, like, and watch more for your heart's content. And stay tuned for more spooky Halloween videos this month. So long.